So we're just going to move on with the time of worship. Mark and Karen are obviously on holiday this week, having a great time in the heat while we're in the rain. Not that we're jealous in any way whatsoever, right? Let's all stand together. I'm just going to pray. Father, I just thank you for our time in your presence this morning. Lord, I just pray that you will open our hearts to receive what you have for us today. Lord, I just pray that we will worship you in spirit and in truth, Lord, with all of our hearts. And Lord, I just pray that you will meet us where you need us, where we need you the most. In Jesus' name, amen. I can't hear my guitar. Thank you. gratitude. The words in this just really, first learned it when we were at Harrogate on conference, and the words just really spoke to my soul. Just that, throw up my hands in abandon to God and worshiping Him.
Thank you.
give to a king, Lord, but that you accept us as we are. And Lord, that we can lift up our voices and praise your holy name.
Here I am to bow down. Here I am to serve. To my God. come around the communion table in a moment. Just a warm welcome, those of you that maybe your first time or second time, your relative guests to us. There's a warm welcome to you. It's the summer, so Mark's away and Malcolm's away. So Elaine turned around to me first thing this morning and she said, Gareth, who's doing communion? I said, no idea. Do you want me to do it? And she said, yes, please. So I'm doing communion this morning, so I'm going to need some help. So I was just thinking and praying there, Stuart and Sam, would you mind helping me? You don't have to get up yet. Just help me serve the things in a minute. So I was racking my brains thinking, because I always like to do something slightly fresh, and I was thinking, and all I could think of was food, which is appropriate. It's quite common for me to think of food. Any of you like passwords in your computers, and you're trying to think of what passwords you can use? Now, there's a funny story at the YMCA that I look after, that I keep forgetting my bankline password, which is how you log into the bank. I'm not going to tell you what it is now, because that would kind of be foolish. But I forgot it once, and so it asked me for another one. So I used another one I was familiar with, and I forgot that. So I put another one, and now I've gone through all the ones I can remember. So I've had to start going to food as my recourse to passwords. And so I was going through food. So anyway, I'm thinking about food. And Gareth, you're all thinking, God, goodness me, where's this going? And how does this link to communion? Have you ever gone to a restaurant and you open the menu? And the way it's always laid out is you have starters, yes? And sometimes it's olives and everything else, which are ridiculously expensive. And then you have the main thing. And then you have the desserts. And so you have your starters, your mains, and your desserts. Jesus was celebrating the Passover meal, which is a Jewish festival, with his disciples. And after the meal, the Bible says, after the meal, he took the bread. And when he gave thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, this is my body broken for you. And likewise, he took the cup and gave it to them, saying, this is the blood of the new covenant poured out for the forgiveness of sins. He says, drink this, all of you. And so we have these emblems known as the Eucharist, the communion table. We have these emblems to remember the death of Jesus Christ, his broken body and his blood that was poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of anyone that would call on his name. This is the center point of the Christian faith, the death of Jesus on the cross, his brokenness in body and blood poured out for us, because of our brokenness and sin, so that we would be made whole. But what's interesting is this is the starter. Because he said, I will not drink this cup with you again until I welcome to you to myself. The last cup of the Passover meal was called the cup of I will bring you to myself. I will bring you to my land. I will bring you to where I am. And so this carries a promise. It's the starter before the main course. And so it carries with it an anticipation of further good, an anticipation of wholeness, an anticipation of the main course and the dessert with the cherry on top. And so for those of you that like your dessert, that's coming. This is telling you it's coming. He says, do this as often as you meet to remember me. Remind yourselves that this is the starter. Remind yourselves that the main course is on its way. That you might live in this land where there's a slight sense of dissatisfaction, that haven't quite been filled with all that is prepared. This sense of hunger for more of God, hunger for more of goodness, hunger for more hope. That hope is true and alive. This table tells you this is the starter, the main course is coming. It's fascinating that he served the starter after the Passover meal, but he served the starter after the Passover meal because he was telling us of what is to come, not what is behind. And in the same way, as we approach this, and I'm going to pray, and then Stuart and Sam are going to help me, and we're going to pray. This table represents the love of God for you, his brokenness in the midst of our brokenness, and his blood shed in the midst of the pain and our own wickedness and our own sin and our own brokenness, so that we would be made whole and we will be brought into his presence and to him. This is the holy table, but it's also the table of God's love, God's welcome, and God's redemption. you are redeemed. So if you love Jesus this morning and you've guessed with us, you're welcome to take this. You don't have to have been converted under our flag or whatever banner. If you love Jesus, you're welcome to be part of the celebration and part of the starter meal that we've got today. So Sam and Stuart, would you come? And I'm just going to pray. Father, I thank you today for sending Jesus, that as he bled and he died for us, we would be made whole. And Lord, as we take this simple meal together to remember you, Lord, would you in our hearts just remind us of your love for us and what it means to be welcomed into your kingdom, we ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Please take your seats. I don't know if there's any announcements today, so I'm not going to make any, but apparently the email that will go out has the announcements on it, so those go through. How are we enjoying our summer? I mean, June was all right. I think we got it then. It reminds me of when I lived in Scotland, actually, because June was the summer in Scotland, and then it just disappeared after that, and that seems to be what's happening right now. Europe's getting all of the too hot, and we're getting enough of it, and it's kind of like, if only we could find some balance. There we are. Sam and I were talking about balance earlier when we were talking about running businesses. So bless you. So has anybody ever been for a job interview? Most people? Some people have been for a job interview. Yes, there's a few over there. Some people do job interviews as well. Has anybody done job interviews? Yeah. Which would you say was harder, doing the interviews or having an interview? Doing. Somebody's having, you had a bad experience. do you know, I don't know, actually. I really enjoy the job interview I did about 5 years ago when I took one on here. I really enjoyed it. I walked away thanking them for the experience. It was a 4.5-hour job interview with multiple different people, but I ended up just saying thank you for the privilege, and I really enjoyed myself. And so I really enjoyed my job interview, but I find it very hard to interview people. And the reason I find it very hard to interview people is I'm sitting in a position where I'm having to make a judgment over somebody's character, over the culture that somebody has, and over the skills they say they've got. And I know the experience of having been confident in the decision and employing somebody, and then finding out afterwards that they weren't quite what you thought they were. And often it's the case when you interview people or when you speak to people for the first time that you're making judgments over them. But do you really know what you're judging? You know, that first impression, that judgment that we cast over people, which really is often the job interview, is often so wrong that we totally got that person wrong. And often, in businesses and things, you might get invited for a second interview. And the purpose of the second interview is trying to get a bit more under the skin. But even at second interview sometimes, we still get them wrong. And I just find it absolutely fascinating. I was slightly off topic already, but I find it absolutely fascinating how bad we are at human beings at judging each other. Both bad in terms of getting it right and bad in terms of doing it often. Like even now, if you're hearing me preach for the first time, you're making judgments over whether I'm good enough or not. The reason we're doing the offering afterwards is not because we forgot it. We forgot it. But if any of you have ever been in other churches I've led, I forget the offering all the time. So we've forgotten the offering. But the good thing about putting the offering last is if my preach isn't good enough, put less in. Because you're not getting what you pay for. Which is slightly cynical, right? It's cynical, Gareth, cynical. But there's an air of truth to it in the way we transact in life. And if I'm not getting much out of this, I'm not going to put much into this. Yeah? I mean, some of us have been in churches, in different churches, in different environments, and how many of us are guilty of thinking, well, that's not as good as the last one I went to? Or I prefer the way they do that over there? How many of us are guilty of that? As if Jesus dreamed of churches and believers that would do that to one another. Whoosh. Just cut straight to the point, Gareth. So I'm actually supposed to be talking on self-righteousness today. But let me ask this question then. If you ask this question of yourself, who am I? And start to dig into the weeds of who you are, your character, your culture, your skills. If you were to job interview yourself for this role, 1 hour, one-to-one, with a perfect holy God. That's the job you get an hour with the perfect holy God. Are you worthy? How do you measure up with everybody else? I got an amazing privilege, which I haven't told many people about, but I got the amazing privilege of meeting Prince William the other day when he came down to engage with homelessness in the area. And he turned up with all of these Range Rovers, and there's police there and everything, and you know, came in and hello, doing this lovelies. And no tie. And it was interesting because I was with a group of people and we were all chatting away and they were all saying, oh, you know, do we curtsy? You know, do I bow like that? And they asked, what are you going to do? I said, well, I'm going to do what Mr. Bean did. And if you have seen Mr. Bean, I'll try not to nut him. He's too high. I couldn't have nutted him anyway. So some of you're gone now, aren't you? That whole scene with the because his dental floss is stuck in his teeth and everything. How do you greet a prince, right? Am I worthy to? And so there was a select group that were chosen to meet the prince, and I had been selected. They didn't know. They don't know who I really am. Clearly, they have no idea. They would have chosen somebody else. But it was with a select group of people. But what was nice about him is he seemed like the kind of guy you would invite for a barbecue and just really have good fun with. He was completely unassuming, no tie, didn't want people to worry about curtsying, wasn't worried about ties. And he was just an ordinary bloke trying to make people feel as ease as possible because he recognizes that his position and influence is such that people could be intimidated by that. And so he was trying to put you at ease. And it was really nice. I mean, fly the flag for Prince William. He couldn't have been more gentle, more humble, and kinder, and just genuinely was eye contact interested in what you had to say. And recognizing he's got to go through how many millions of people as he's got to go through the entourage and everything else, but he took the time to listen and to have some sort of connection. And I really enjoyed it. Now, I had that privilege. Why I wasn't worthy of that. It wasn't about worth. It was about meeting somebody with a common purpose in mind. But fast forward that to, are you worthy to have an hour one-to-one with a perfect, holy creator of the universe? Like, what would be the shortlist for that one? If there were six of us to meet Prince William, what would be the shortlist for that one? Now, in our culture, we judge one another by our character, by our history, by our story, by their worthiness. Who would you not invite for dinner in your household? Or maybe I can put it a different way. Let's say, for example, I meet some old friends that Sonia hasn't met, and they're in town, and come over my house. Come over my house, right? And I'll pick the best time for you, love. It's 4 o'clock in the afternoon on a weekday, right? Just finishing work, right? And I send a text saying, love, we've got 4 people coming over for dinner tonight, and it's a Wednesday, right? Midweek, right? Everything gets sorted out by the end of Sunday, ready for the week again kind of thing. And there's all sorts of stuff going on in the house. The kids are all over the place. Naomi's got a sleepover somewhere. And we've got to cancel that. I'm bringing all of these people around. Who are they? Oh, you don't know who they are. What are they like? No idea. Just make some stuff. Like, I'm bringing them over. They're coming over at 5:30. And Sonia's in Blandford St. Mary at school. She's got to get back. Like, I've got to try and sort the house out. The cat, I've got to move the cat somewhere if they're allergic to that. I've got to clear the boxes up, because why is it the cats like to sit in cardboard boxes and everything else? And apparently there's a conspiracy going around that cats have invented Amazon so that they can have free boxes to sit in. It's good. You know what happens? You get all the bits that are kind of lying around, you shove them in the cupboards, You know, there's used glasses sitting in the airing cupboard because there was nowhere else to put them as you're running around, and you get the whole thing sorted out, and then they arrive and everything's sorted and everything's bringing these random people around, and it's kind of like, who would you not have? Who would you not do that for? Because there's people in your life, surely, that you wouldn't have over for dinner. And like, you would resent if I brought them. Like, I'm supposed to be the pastor, right? So the pastor says, I'm bringing people to your house for dinner. Like, how rude. How inconvenient. And yet these are the sorts of things that we read about in the Bible that Jesus does. I'm going to turn in the Bible. Goodness me, Gareth, you got to the scriptures finally. Turn in the Bible to Luke 19. Luke 19, it reads like this. He, that's Jesus, entered Jericho and was passing through. And there was a man by the name of Zacchaeus. And he was a chief tax collector. I love this line. And he was rich. Zacchaeus was trying to see who Jesus was and was unable because of the crowd, for he was small in stature. He might be rich, but he's little. Yeah, doesn't have everything. So he ran on ahead and climbed up the sycamore tree in order to see him, for he was about to pass through that way. When Jesus came to the place, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, hurry and come down, for today I will stay at your house. They have mobile phones, right? Zacchaeus is now texting ahead. Honey, we got 13 for dinner. We'll be over in 10 minutes. The glasses are going in the airing cupboard. She's running around trying to sort everything out. The Hoover's going around like that. The cat's been kicked, you know. And it's just, it's all going on, right? And so you know, they're coming over. And he hurried and came down and received him gladly. In fact, the Greek there is he rejoiced. He was just beside himself with happiness that Jesus chose him to come to dinner. Like the prince is coming. And he hurried down and was gladly. And when they saw it, they all began to grumble, saying, he has gone to be a guest of a man who is a sinner. Zacchaeus stopped and said to the Lord, behold, Lord, half of my possessions I will give to the poor. And if I have defrauded anyone of anything, I will give it back four times as much. And Jesus said to him, today salvation has come to this house, because he too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. Zacchaeus is a chief tax collector. How many of us like our self-assessment forms if you fill them in? All right, for those of you that have had your first paycheck, you remember back to your first paycheck, right? And you get your first paycheck and you don't understand what the numbers mean, right? So you start reading through and you find the bottom line number. Okay, that's how much I'm going to get paid. And then you look up. And if you're anything like me, the first time you got your PAYE thing through, you went on to an emergency tax code, which eventually you got a bit of refund, but you went on to emergency tax code because they haven't sorted out your P60 and your P45s and all those bits and pieces yet, so you haven't got your thing. So you look up and you see 40% has been taken off in tax. So you look up and you go, how much? Zacchaeus is a chief tax collector. Now back in that day, the taxes went to Rome. They didn't even go to support your NHS. It wasn't even like that softening of the blow of the tax, like, well, at least I get healthcare, all right? And a bit of a pension from this national insurance thing where I was so excited when I was 16 I got my national insurance number because that meant I was an adult, and actually what it really means is you have to pay for the rest of your life. Chief tax, not even just a tax collector, the chief tax collector. In other words, tax collectors work for him, and he drives the income that the other tax collectors need to make for Rome, who are the enemy occupying the city in which you live. So the people who are Jewish are working for the enemy to rob you of your money. You ever watched Robin Hood? This guy is the sheriff of Nottingham. I've met the sheriff of Nottingham. She's lovely. She is. it's funny. I was up in Nottingham the other day, and we met the sheriff, the highest sheriff in Nottingham. So I said, oh, you're the sheriff of Nottingham. My name's Sherwood. I'm Robin Hood. sidestep. Okay, come back to the word, Gareth. So the chief tax collector, probably among the Jewish people, the most hated man in the city, save for the Romans. Nobody respected this person because he got rich by colluding with the enemy and got rich by robbing the poor. Would you have an Instagram photo with this person? Would you like their tweets? Or their exes now, whatever it is now. Would you be Facebook friends with this person? Would you be associated in your name with this person? Would you ring ahead and say, honey, they're coming over for dinner? You wouldn't want them anywhere near you. This is a collaborator. This is somebody who has compromised their integrity and got rich off it. Like it says, he was rich. This guy made money off your suffering. Part of that PAYE money that went to the tax man is actually going into his pocket because he's fleecing it off. That's the tax collector. He's the chief tax collector. Jesus stops at the bottom of a tree and looks up at the chief tax collector of the city and says, among all of these people I could choose from to come and visit, speak to, and engage with conversation as a friend with, among all of these people, that's the guy I'm going to choose. Jesus, this is not the way you do it. I've said it a few times. Jesus clearly didn't have a PR company. He didn't have a PR company because when he got baptized and then the dove descended on him and the heavens opened and the Father spoke and said, this is my son, and all of that sort of stuff going on. The next thing he did was go and spend 40 days in the wilderness and nobody knew where he was. That is wrong timing. You take that moment, you capitalize on it, and you make sure the social media is alive with that moment and everybody knows and the video is shared, right? That's what you do. And clearly, Jesus didn't get the memo about PR because he went into the wilderness where nobody knew where he was for 40 days. He's just missed a big moment, right? So this is another big moment. He's got a crowd of people following him. A few verses earlier, we read about the interaction, and Jesus tells the story of the tax collector and the Pharisee. And he said the Pharisee was praying, and the tax collector was praying, and the Pharisee was saying, thank God I'm not like that man. Thank God I'm shallow like him. Thanks God that I'm not robbing like him. Thank you God that I'm not a sinner like him. Thank you God that I tithe and I do the right things and I'm a good person. Thank you God that I'm a good person. And then the next prayer is the tax collector says, God, I'm a sinner, I'm a mess, I'm so ashamed of myself. Please help me. And then Jesus says in the parable that God listens to him, not to the Pharisee. Pharisees were the it boys of the time. They were the professionals. They were the professional religious people. They were the popular pastors of the day. That's who the Pharisees were. They were the teachers of the law, the people that people respected to teach them, that had everything lined up and were doing everything right. And they had, you know, the right shirt on, not the one that's fading a bit, or the right shoes on, that, you know, and they had it all sorted out. And Jesus says that the tax collector is the one he was listening to. And then the next chapter, Luke has Jesus visiting the chief tax collector among all the people. Now, let's zero back into our culture for a moment. How often have you heard this? I'm a good person. Well, let me ask it differently. Are you? Like, are you good? I'm toying with this at the moment. I think our culture's got a problem. Well, it's got many, right? But I think our culture has got a problem, and that we believe that people are intrinsically good. and then they make mistakes, and that's what makes them bad. In fact, we believe that people are intrinsically whole. And then it's trauma and things that happen to them and decisions they make that make them bad people. Which is exactly what the Pharisees believed about the tax collectors. We've got this idea that you're born good. Here's the problem with that. If you believe that you're born good and then it's your failures that let you down, but you get to go to heaven if you're good, and it's all about protecting your goodness. It's all about sustaining, in the Bible we would call it self-righteousness. Which means that the way you interact with people when somebody puts you down or says you failed or says you've made a mistake or says that, you know, you've got a problem with your character flaw is to defend yourself and prove them wrong or criticize them to make out that you're better than them so that you can turn around to God when you pray and say, thank God that I'm not like them. The problem with a culture that intrinsically teaches the narrative of childhood and everything else, that you are good, you're not broken, you're not flawed, and that you will be by your mistakes judged, is that there is no framework for redemption, because once you've made your mistakes, you've broken the rules, you've broken it, it's part of your story, it's who you are now. Not who you were, it's who you are now. You've let me down. You've let them down, and frankly, you've let yourself down. That narrative, right? That there's no fixing the past. So there's no way of overcoming that story. That'll always be part of you. It'll be on your record like a DBS form. It'll be on your Ofsted record, like the Ofsted inspection from 20 years ago when you had requiring improvement back then. You may be excellent now, but look at your past. A leopard never changes its spots. You have this story that you have to maintain appearance so that other people accept you, because we know full well that when you've got a history and a story that makes people understand you differently, they will reject you. If we believe that everybody's good and it's only your mistakes that make you a bad person, and that's the way the culture's functioning, there's no room for forgiveness, there's no room for redemption, and all you have to look forward to if you make a bad enough mistake is rejection. That you're out. That will remove you from our Facebook friends. It's that simple these days. We reject people with a click of a button. And if you don't believe me, I read an interesting statistic last week. 27% of Generation Zers and Millennials no longer talk to their parents and haven't done for years because they disagree with some of the decisions their parents have made. 27% no longer talk to their parents. There are stories of 10 years. I read the story. It was 10 years this girl never spoke to her father. He died and she never communicated to him. And her words written down in this thing was, I still can't figure out whether I did a bad thing or not. Because I cannot face the fact that I have to deal with my own judgment. And I have to maintain this pretense that I didn't make a mistake. Because otherwise I would be rejected in the culture. And I know that I would be unfriended just like everybody else. And the problem with that unfriend button, God bless you, Facebook. But the problem with that unfriend button is it teaches everybody that uses social media that it's that simple to stop a relationship with somebody. And people are doing it with their own parents. What's that going to do to you? Let me tell those 27% of millennials, how do you think your children are going to treat you? The Bible says, honor your father and mother so that your days will be long on the earth. And yet you unfriend like that. If that happened to this culture, good luck. And the base root of all of that is self-righteousness. I'm better than you. Thank God I'm not like them. I don't want to appear associated with those people because my friend group who accept this, 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 and this, and this is the way you have to live your life, would not accept me if I accepted the way they think or they talk about those people over there. And so because of that, I'm going to unfriend them, and I want nothing to do with them, and I'm not going to go to their house to have dinner. Jesus Christ, at the bottom of the tree, looks up and says to the most hated man in the city, I'm coming to yours for dinner. And the result was, all the people that were following him started to talk about, how dare he do that? Who does he? Does he not realize this man is filth? Doesn't he realize who he is associating with? And everybody in that group stopped following him on Twitter from that moment. I've lost respect for what you're about to say. I've lost respect for what you're about to do. And they went back to following the scribes and the Pharisees, who would have cast judgment on Jesus' actions in that day. Human wisdom and discernment over somebody's character, over somebody's culture, and over somebody's skills. Jesus just failed the job interview. Not in my club. What's interesting about this is Jesus is revealing something about the kingdom of God. He's revealing something about his character and something about his skill. In the same way we do look into job interviews. You employ by culture, character, and skill. Is it a culture fit? Is it a character fit? Is it a skill fit? Now, painful for many of us today is the realization of this. Jesus will eat with people you hate. In fact, he will choose to go to dinner with them over you. If you don't like that, it's because you don't like his kingdom. It's not that his kingdom loves injustice. No. Is that his kingdom doesn't judge the way you judge. His kingdom doesn't judge you the way you judge you. And his kingdom doesn't judge them the way you judge them. In fact, the only reason this makes sense is if Zacchaeus' righteousness or worthiness of meeting Prince William is dependent on someone other than himself. In other words, if your goodness to kind of get to eternity or stand before God or enjoy blessings in life was determined purely on you, how many of us, if we're deeply honest, when I asked you to look inside and find out who you are, would have held your hands up and said, not my house? It wouldn't have happened for me. Jesus says, if that's you, that's the house I'm going to. But if you hold your hand up and you say, I'm worthy, come to my house, look at all the good works I've done, look at all the great things I am, look at my character, look at my personality, look at my Facebook profile, you won't see a bad picture in there. There's not even a dot on teeth and a smile. Look at if you, the outside of the cup is looking beautiful to everybody else, Jesus is not going to be interested in visiting your house. But if you're deeply open and honest about your own brokenness, if the center of your soul connects with the truth that I'm broken, not good, then that's the house Jesus is coming to. Why? Because that's the place he needs to be. He says it here. The Son of Man has come to seek and save that which was lost. That it's not about knowing I'm good, supporting my own goodness, making sure everybody else knows I'm good, and then when I get to go to heaven, God will compare me to the tax collector and say, I'm good. But it's about connecting with your own brokenness, recognizing everybody else is broken too, and beginning to step into a different perspective of people and the world in which we live. Would it be interesting if our job interviews accepted brokenness? How much less intimidated would you feel then? That if you go along to the job interview and the person interviewing says, we like people that made mistakes here. We're looking for people that recognize that they need to learn. Looking for people that are connected with their history and the story, and they've lived a track record and actually want to move on from some of those difficulties and some of those mistakes they've made, want to improve in their character and want to step into a new opportunity with a fresh verve, a fresh life, a fresh passion, building on the brokenness of their past so that they may step into a wholeness of future. That's what we're looking for. Would you like to work for us? Oh, by the way, when you make a mistake in this organization, we look at it as a learning experience. That actually, we encourage people to acknowledge when they messed up and to be open and honest about it, because then together we can deal with it. That when you come and work for us, we recognize that you're going to fail at this job description, but that's okay, because the job description is there to give you an ideal of what you can attain, knowing full well that you're going to make mistakes along the way. But don't worry, we'll pay for those mistakes so long as you keep learning. That sounds like a pretty good place to work. Oh, and by the way, everybody that works here, we're also connected with our brokenness. We're open and honest about it. And so you won't feel intimidated that somebody's doing a better job than you. They're just further along the learning journey. And that it's okay. Because frankly, we're all still here with our brokenness. And we don't give stars for people's personal attainment because they're all attained, not because of how good they are, but how good the organization is as a whole. And we all win and lose because of that. And by the way, the head of the organization, they're perfect. But the good news is, they actually died for you so that you could be made whole and set this whole system up. And that every mistake you've ever made in your past and every mistake that you've ever made in your future will be covered up and forgotten for eternity, because you will be presented faultless at the end when you come to retire. And your employment record will be perfect. And you know what the payout is, what your retirement pension is? It is an eternity of joy and provision and hope, where perfect peace will belong to you for all time. I'd work for that organization. Friends, that's the church. That organization is the church. It's what Jesus set up. Jesus is doing here, by going to dinner with a tax collector, is he saying this: I can redeem the most broken among you, the most hated among you, the most undeserving among you, and turn them from somebody who is rich and self-indulgent into somebody that is a blessing and transforms the lives of thousands because of his wealth that has been turned on its head and then becomes a force for good. It's just, what I don't get is why that's not attractive to people. I also don't get is why we don't preach it more often. It says, you are the righteousness of God in Christ. That's what the Bible says. It says, because of his great love, he has given you a hope beyond hope. Because of who he is, not because of who you are. This table is, this is my blood poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. This is my body broken for you. This table represents the fact that you will never have a righteousness that's good enough to be in the presence of God, but you don't need one because you get his righteousness. And the good thing about that is, if you try and sin it out of you, his righteousness overcomes it, because the sin is buried in death. So his righteousness is one you can't spoil. Which means the story of your life, when you think you're born good and then you lose it over time, is disappeared, because you can't lose his righteousness so long as you maintain a hope in him. It also means that me standing up here, Pastor Gareth, who's broken as broken gets, who even on Friday, and I've got somebody who was sitting in the room, was having a right old moan about somebody. And I've got to stop this because I'm in a bad place. Forgive me, God. Move on. Let's get out of this place. I'm right old moan. But it's not about judging them that way, right? You are the righteousness of God in Christ. You are perfect and have nothing to prove to anyone. No. Wind back. Hear that again. You are perfect, and you have nothing to prove to anyone. You yourself are broken, but because of Christ, have nothing to prove to anyone. How liberating is it? It means you don't have to try and be fixed. You don't have to prove you're fixed to people. You don't have to prove you've got it all together, that you're smart enough, fast enough, quick enough, you're able to set the table well enough, do the dishes complete enough, work hard enough. All of that can be something out of what God has made you. But you and yourself are righteous in Christ. The righteous. It means this. When God in his judgment seat looks at you, he sees perfection because he sees Jesus. That's who Jesus is. This guy who they all grumbled about and moaned and groaned about and unfriended and stopped following on Twitter, this guy who met with Zacchaeus and went to his house, this guy, because of what he has done, makes Zacchaeus whole and everybody else who recognizes they're messed up. And so, friends, if I can leave you with one thought, it's connect back to your culture, connect back to where we are as a community of people, and to understand this, you do not have to prove yourself. You do not have to protect your own righteousness. You do not have to make out like you're good to everybody else. You don't have to hold your head at the consecrated angle as the preacher preaches, unless your head is just, you know, doing that anyway, because a lot of people do. And I've loved that bit, because everybody who's doing it then goes, except for the rebels who keep it there because they're like, yeah, he said that, but I don't have to move. And, right, so some of the heads have just gone back. It's funny. You don't have to prove yourself that Jesus, through the cross, through what he has done, makes you righteous before God, heals your brokenness, and sets you on a path of the learning journey, like I described in the job description when you get the job, of you can walk through your brokenness, and over time, as you work with him and he works with you, the Holy Spirit will bring you to perfection, and that's a process called sanctification. That is the gospel. The good news is, you don't have to be perfect. Prince William's coming, and he's not looking for perfection. Jesus is coming, and he's not looking for perfection. And the entourage that are following, no matter what they think about you, it's what he thinks about you that matters. And he's made you perfect through his blood. So every mistake you've made, every mistake you're making, and every mistake you're going to be making can be laid at the feet of that cross, and it dies there. And it won't follow you anymore. Other people might remind you of it, but God won't. The devil might remind you of it. But God won't. It's buried with Christ. And you carry his robes, his reputation, his righteousness, his goodness into every space you go. And you can just be learning all the time. I'm broken. I'm on the mend. I don't have to be fixed. I don't have to have it all sorted out. God thinks I'm good enough. That's good enough for me. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this higgledy-piggledy sermon, which in some ways leads us to a place of acknowledgement, not just of our own brokenness, but just how loving and welcoming you are. Lord, one of the hardest things that I don't think I'll ever understand is why you love me. Because there's no why, right? You just do. Like Zacchaeus, you came to seek and save that which is lost. And Lord, I'm lost. I'm always lost. And without you, Lord, I don't know where I'd be. But Lord, help me to love the broken. Help me, like Sam and Stuart today, to take that which is broken and serve it to the broken, so that we all might be made whole. And Lord, remind me when I get filled of my own self-righteousness and self-importance that that's not what the kingdom is about. That your culture that you bring to my job interview is one that seeks and saves that which is lost and broken, that has a redemptive theme, not a rejective theme, that welcomes, that loves, that does not reject and abandon. And Lord, for each and every one of us, and we bring all sorts to the room here today, whether we've come here and we've got it all sorted out, We've forgotten that we're still broken until we start lifting the layers and find what's underneath. Or whether we've come here, Lord, we just limped in. And we've broken in half right now. Lord, we invite you to our hearts today. As you tell us, get out of the tree, come down. Come down and be with me. Let's go together to the center of your life. And let's have food. And Lord, as we ate the starter today, which is the prelude to the main meal, Lord, we ask that by your Holy Spirit, you just work in us now. You'd bring us healing where we need healing. You'd bring us hope where we need hope. You'd restore where we feel broken. You'd bring your love where we feel abandoned. We'd bring your perfection where we see so much imperfection. And in this moment, Lord, we ask that you would help us as we limp through life until we get to the main course of perfection, where every tear will be wiped away and all joy will be complete. Thank you, Jesus, for the cross. Thank you, Jesus, for choosing to eat at our house. And Lord, we pray you would make us a breath of fresh air into a culture that can't cope with its own brokenness. We ask that in Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together. Take up the offering while we're singing this last song. Any volunteers? Jack? Oh no, okay, sorry, you've been out your circle.
Yeah.
I just pray that in everything that we do this week, Lord, that we will make room for you in our lives, Lord. Through the busyness, Lord, and the chaos that can sometimes be our daily lives, Lord, I just pray that we will make room for you. And Lord, that you'll go with us now, Lord, and be with us. May we take your presence with us this week, wherever we go. In Jesus' name, amen.